Hello and welcome to Artifacts, the monthly show on City Cable 34, in which we talk about the arts in Minneapolis. A little bit later on, we'll be talking with Barb Benjamin-Robertson, who's a staff person for the Minneapolis Arts Commission. She works with their neighborhood arts program. But first, I'm very excited to have with us mayoral candidate and City Council President Sharon Sayles-Belton. We're having on the show each month the declared candidates for the office of mayor in the city of Minneapolis to talk a little bit about what the arts mean to Minneapolis and what perhaps the role of the city might be in working with the arts. Sharon, thanks a lot for coming on to the show.
Thanks, very nice to be here.
Now, I know you're well aware of many of the cultural resources we've got here in the city of Minneapolis, but I wondered if you could just share with us a little bit what your view of the arts in Minneapolis are. And I don't mean in an official way necessarily, but just what your impression of the arts is in Minneapolis.
Well, what I'd just say generally, Phil, is that I think the city of Minneapolis has a wealth of arts opportunities in the city. I think most of the arts that get the bulk of the attention in the city are going to be those things like the Guthrie and the Walker and the Institute of Art and the Symphony, etc. And these are all very fine institutions as well. You know, the city has been playing a role in expanding theater arts. And more recently, we've been talking about trying to work with neighborhood and community in developing, you know, arts on the neighborhood level, arts that are really designed to reach the grassroots. I don't think we're doing that exclusively. I think our traditional arts organizations are as well understanding that it's important for, you know, art to transcend race and class. And I think they're doing an extraordinary job in making that transition. And I would just comment that the Walker and the Institute of Art are doing an exceptional job, and I'm really pleased to see that.
So you see kind of a balancing act here between the major institutions, but also more grassroots kind of effort as well.
I think you have people tend to think that arts are something that just the rich and cultured are a part of, and I think that there have been things that have gone on in the past that, you know, that perpetuate that myth. But art really belongs to everybody. Art is a form of, you know, our lives. It's our spirit. It's our hope for the future. It is as well. I think in an educational medium that we have yet to tap all that it can do for us.
Now, you just raised the question for me. What do you think the role of arts and young people could be, or maybe should be?
Well, I think a lot of people have been talking about the importance of drawing our young people into art so they can understand it, so that they can appreciate it, so they can experience it, so that they can, you know, share, you know, part of their selves through art. I think that art is also history, art is life, and so I think to the extent that we want our young people to grow up balanced, I think that it's important for us to expose them to art at an early age. And I think it's important to expose them to a variety of art forms so they don't get the impression that it's just the Mona Lisa that's sitting in a museum, you know, over in France that's art, but it as well is the little flower garden that you're creating on the corner of 34th and Chicago Avenue, or the mural painting that the young people did in South Minneapolis on 12th and Lake Street. That's art, and the community was involved in it, and that's just as important as some of the more expensive pieces of art that people would just love to have.
Yeah, on an individual basis.
Absolutely.
And I have seen the magic of art in the lives of young people and this and that. The arts are often looked at, though, as maybe secondary or something you have to take care of after you solve some of the other problems in a city or in a state or nationally. And it's no secret we're maybe coming out of a bit of a recession here that's lasted a long time and caused a lot of stress for people. Maybe things are looking up. We've got a new administration out in Washington. But the city has challenges too. How do you see finding a balance between the role of the city with the arts and the role of the city in so many other critical areas?
Well, to be perfectly honest with you, I never see the city of Minneapolis as being an institution that's going to spend as much money on essential basic services as they are going to provide to the arts community. But I think it's important for the city of Minneapolis to understand that it has to pay attention to all pieces, all facets of the community that make us who we are. We have to understand that things like arts and parks, the things that people would call soft, are very important amenities to a city that make it strong, make it the kind of place that people would, you know, want to bring their business to, would want to live in. Minneapolis is a city that has enjoyed a significant title, a history of being one of the best cities in the country. And I think a part of one of the reasons we have that reputation is because we have such a balanced life as a city. We have strong arts, we have good schools, both public and private. We have strong corporations that have a civic responsibility, and they demonstrate it in a lot of different ways by giving it to the arts and as well to our social programs. We're a very progressive community, and so we look at our problems of poverty and homelessness and the other things that are kind of on the agenda as problems and issues, and understand that we have to pay a lot of attention to them. So it's a balanced perspective that causes me as a member of the Minneapolis City Council and president and mayoral candidate to say that it's important for us to have a relationship with the arts community. I don't know how that relationship will necessarily change over the next couple of years. But what I would say is that it is important for us to try to find avenues to draw arts into public policy. The city of Minneapolis is involved in development in a lot of different ways. I think we ought to be considering ways in which we can create opportunities for Minnesota and artists in the Twin City area to be a part of the growth of the city of Minneapolis. We can do that as we think about constructing buildings. We can do it as we think about expanding educational curriculum. There are a lot of ways in which elected officials can facilitate the expression of art. And we have to be creative. We have to be innovative. It's not just an issue of taking 1% out of our budget and saying, well, this will be for arts. Let's try to find many ways, many avenues to get art expressed.
Maybe use some of that creative energy that the artists are so well known for to come in and help work on some other problems.
I think that would be a wonderful idea. I will just tell you, I sat in with the Powderhorn Neighborhood Group as we were selecting the artist who was going to tell the story of the Powderhorn Neighborhood. And as you know, it's a very diverse community with European Americans, African Americans, Asians, American Indian, just a very diverse community. And to have the artists come in and talk about ways in which they could use their own art forms to help us tell such a diverse story was just very interesting to see, hear, and to visualize. Now, there's no reason why we can't take an experience like that and make the backdrop be the city of Minneapolis and ask artists to talk to us about ways in which they can help us express Minneapolis in a way that's positive. Let me just mention one other thing, because your question brings this to mind. We've been working on the interpretation of the St. Anthony Falls area, and I had an opportunity to meet a woman who is very interested in using water to, you know, express, using water to express art or art to express water. I don't know which way I should really think about that. But one of the things she talked about is that it was really important for us to not just create museums, not just create educational plaques that children could read and then they could visualize what was going on hundreds of years ago along the Mississippi River, but we should also take an art form and help them to understand how the water really has influenced our life, how the water is a part of the ecosystem that's really important, and we should really understand it. And she had these wonderful, fantastic images that she wanted to explore. And I told her, I said, you know, this is wonderful. I mean, this is really what we ought to be, you know, having art do. Not only give us some beauty, but also teach us something. Help us to understand how essential it is and how critical it is to life. Art can do so much more than just give us beauty. And I think we have to think about that, and I think we have to understand that.
Sharon, that's a wonderful answer. And watching your eyes light up as you describe this water image and that. We've got about time for one more question. Do you have a personal background in any of the art forms yourself? Or what is it you and your family likes to do when you head out for a cultural night or a weekend or something like that?
Well, my husband is very involved in the walker, so we go to the walker a lot, and sometimes we take the children. It's easier to take them to the sculpture garden than it is for us to, you know, take them to a new show. But I mean, that's what we'll do. The family day at the Art Institute is just a really wonderful experience for, you know, a family to do together, or for the aunts and uncles to maybe do with the, you know, mm-hmm. do with the nieces and nephews. Hint, hint, hint.
so if they're watching.
So if they're watching, you know, the kids would like to go. Mm-hmm. There really are a lot of different things that are available. In our family, we're going to do anything from, you know, the Walker, the Art Institute, the Children's Museum, you know, to camp, Snoopy. But I'll also tell you the other thing that I do. I really believe in artistic expression. And so my children have a lot of construction paper and scissors and glue and paints, and these things are all kind of messy. But I just think it's really important you know, to give them an opportunity to understand that they can create art. So we go out with some things, but we also do art projects at home. I bought a wonderful book called Touch. To those who are maybe listening who have children, it helps children understand art through tactile experiences. They're wonderful things. The Center for the Book Arts is a wonderful program for families and children. There are just a lot of choices in the city of Minneapolis to get family to kind of come together and explore the arts.
Well, great. Sounds like you guys have some fun when you go out.
Yeah.
Sharon, thanks for being on the show.
Thank you.
Good luck in the coming year.
All right.
And we will be back in just a moment. Please stay tuned for a quick look at an art fact about Minneapolis. And welcome back. Now, in a moment, I'm going to introduce one of my favorite people here at City Hall who works in the Neighborhood Arts Program. But one quick note, as Sharon was leaving, I found out after we taped our segment with her that she does have a personal background in the arts. She was a dancer and actually studied dance for a while in the great city of New York. So we're glad that she's back here and thought you might like to know that. And as I mentioned, Barb Benjamin-Robertson, who's the staff person with the Minneapolis Arts Commission, works in the Neighborhood Arts Program, is here. And we're going to talk a lot about the Neighborhood Arts Program and some of the things she's been involved in for quite a few years here at City Hall. Barb, thanks for joining us on the show. Great.
Thank you.
Now, you brought some slides, and in a moment we're going to see some of the imagery of some of the neighborhood arts projects that you've worked with and the Arts Commission's done. But I want to get a little background first. I often, when people say, what is this program? I usually call it the New Presenters Program. But what is the full real name?
It's a long name. It's the Minority Ethnic and Neighborhood Arts New Presenters Program.
Okay, and it's administered by the Minneapolis Arts Commission.
Right.
And what's its history? When did this start, and who can be part of it?
In 1984, a study was done that involved a survey to neighborhood groups and organizations, and they offered their input as to what was needed in the community. And so from that came the beginning of the Neighborhood Arts Program, and it was called that. It's a long name, but it kind of wanted to be inclusive of everybody.
Right. And as I understand it, this project is really, to be eligible for it, you have to be based in a neighborhood or in a community setting. It isn't exactly a program that goes directly to artists. It goes first to the neighborhood groups? How
right.
does that work?
It provides arts, or not arts, but neighborhood groups to become sponsors of projects in the neighborhood. Involving collaborative efforts between the artists and arts organization and the neighborhoods, and then they develop something that they believe is important in their community.
Okay, and then they might contract with whomever they want.
Right.
Now, among the other roles in your life, I know you do a lot of different things. You're an artist yourself.
Great.
And I'm not sure if the camera can do this. I didn't give them any warning about this, but you're wearing some of the beadwork you work on.
Yep, I do. A lot of Native American beadwork, and I've been fascinated by that. The beadwork, I've been into painting and drawing and just couldn't find my medium. But then I met a friend through a Scrabble tournament, and we became involved in beading, and then the more I became interested in it, the more I just was ready to just take off on it, and I'm fascinated now by the little people, the little princesses, actually.
Well, the one, I hope the camera picked it up, but it's beautiful what you're wearing. So.
Thank you.
Let's turn now, if we can, to the slides of some of the different neighborhood art projects that you've been involved in. Mm-hmm. And if you will, as it comes up on the screen, just share with us a little bit about what we're seeing and some of the background of it and that.
Okay, these are, the slides are from projects I've funded in 1992. And this one was the American Indian Student Association at the U of M. They did a traditional powwow focusing on the community and involving anybody that would like to join and share in this, the culture. Mm-hmm. And I like this slide because it shows a variety of people, and then also the police participated in
that the, person the pretty
final
close to
dance.
The middle in there. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And then the traditional dancer on the right of the screen. Mm-hmm. Great. What else did you bring that we can?
Well, we have the. This is again some more of the dancers that were.
Oh, I see.
Were mm-hmm. there, and it's very beautiful.
Sure, and that was held on campus?
At the Phillips Park over on 24th and Cedar, right off over there.
Sure, great.
Now this is a project by the Fans Project of Pillsbury Neighborhood Services.
Mm-hmm.
Worked with three youth to develop their artistic talents, and this was done by a younger youth that was learning new techniques, and this is called the Aztec art. He found out he was actually his heritage is from the Aztec Empire, whatever. And
do you remember the name of that particular artist?
Guillermo Garza.
Okay, because
and this one here is by Adrian Garza, his younger brother,
who was on this show about a year and a half ago.
Yeah, and he developed his technique also on. On this piece, and I, if you had to see this piece to just,
can you do you know offhand where that is, that particular piece?
It's let's on see, one they did four different murals with four participating organizations, and one was Big Brothers and Big Sisters of Minneapolis,
that's Greater up on
Minneapolis,
the north side?
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And the Curry Center, and
over that's West Bank.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And Pillsbury Grand Mat, they worked with the youth, and it was really moving to see that the youth could work with a larger corporation in developing some kind of a theme.
It's nice to see Adrian's work continuing. Here's mm-hmm. another picture here. Now, this is a different project.
Right. This is back when ArtStop was funded in, I believe, in 1990, and they had their first competition. And the neighborhood people
mm-hmm.
voted
shot.
on right. who would design the pieces, and then they were funded again. Of course, they get funding from different sources besides the Arts Commission.
But you're part of the catalyst.
We're
for
part
that.
Of it, mm-hmm.
and this is up at Chicago Avenue,
right? 32nd and Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
And here they, it's. You can see what becomes of this vacant spot where there's now beautiful flowers and
sure. Looks like an opening celebration going on there with a little music
mm-hmm.
and things. Great.
And that's what happens at this next. This one was also a vacant lot on 12th and Lake, and mm-hmm. the multicultural youth from the Phillips and the Powderhorn neighborhood worked together with the neighborhood residents and. Developed this unity theme,
mm-hmm.
and now it's a garden of delight. You can.
We've got images here on this turtle. Can you briefly tell us what those are? They symbolize something.
Those are symbols that the youth worked on to. I can't really tell you what, but I know mm-hmm. the turtle is a symbol of a lot of. Different cultures
I must
that
say,
comes into the storytelling and
when I drive down Lake Street and I see that there on 12th, it's a striking image and a beautiful work. taking what was, I remember that, as a vacant lot, and it's turned out to be beautiful. So, well, tell us now, if you will, a little bit about the future of the program. How do people get involved? You have a round, as they call it, in the...
The ninth round.
Ninth round is coming up this spring, 93.
Right. And I'll be mailing those, a bulk mailing of, it will go out January 4th.
Okay, so early the month of January. And then when does the actual round, when do people have to respond?
They need to respond by mailing in the postcard, which is attached to the back, by March 5th. Okay. And then the proposals are due the March 25th, the Friday. I think it's the 26th.
Whatever that Friday is in there in March.
Right.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I know that you have memorized a number, so if people had questions, they've been watching some of these slides, and they wanted to know a little bit more about it or to get on a mailing list to have the application sent, what number would people call?
The 673-2624 number.
Okay.
That's for the Neighborhood Arts.
We'll put that on the screen. So once again, if people want to call about the Neighborhood Arts program, they should call
673-2624.
Okay, that's good. It's a wonderful program. Rough estimate, how many of these programs, if this is around nine, that means there have been eight so far,
mm-hmm.
How many projects have happened in the last 8 years?
181.
Wow, and all through the city?
Right.
Yeah, I know that in the, the State of the City book, you've put in there a map with dots, as it were, mm-hmm. all through the city, and it just covers every part of the city where mm-hmm. these different programs. Any highlights, anything that's just really touched you in particular, a project that really thrilled you more than you'd ever expected it would? Or?
Well, there's one that's kind of my favorite, and that's the Homeless Children's Art Project by 410 Shelter, and they worked mm-hmm. with, this artist worked with the children there, and to bring out their creative side so that they could understand more about life through a process that they could understand. And it was their artwork was just beautiful. And now that the pieces are now showing at the Piper Jaffray and Hopwood building,
oh, and their
the family
offices.
Center.
Mm-hmm. Well, great, great.
So.
Good work. Tell us, if you will, what the future is for you and the program. What's going to go on this year?
Well, the position for my program managing this program has been eliminated for, and so my last day would be January 31st of 93. But I have support to go after private funding for the program for more monies, as well as administrative support. And I am currently seeking there are two that I am actively pursuing right now. And from what I've heard, it looks like one of them is pretty sure to
Well, that's
fund
good
that.
News. So you intend then to keep the program going, and people who have seen this and want to get involved can still do that
mm-hmm.
By calling that number. But you've got to go out and kind of hustle to keep yourself at the desk, as it were.
Right. And I also am actively seeking others' opportunities available in the city,
okay.
in the arts, and
good.
Particularly in the neighborhood arts part.
Sure. Any upcoming projects? I sense that from some of the pictures that these tend to be sort of summer, if they're outdoor sort of things.
Mm-hmm.
But they can go on year-round, am I mm-hmm. right?
There's one by CIP, Community Involvement Programs. They worked with people with physical disabilities, and they developed their art through just self-expression and communication, and it will be showing January 5th at the First Unitarian Church over by the Guthrie.
Oh, okay, the Unitarian Society up there.
Great Society. Mm-hmm.
Is that Mount Curve, I guess?
Mm-hmm, 900 okay. Mount Curve.
Great. Okay, is that a one-day only thing?
No, it'll be there for, I believe, a month.
Oh, okay, but starting January 5th
mm-hmm.
of this month.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, that sounds good. Did I see some of those images over at the Hennepin County Government Center? I thought there was...
Right.
By that same group, it was
mm-hmm.
a marvelous show.
That was limited to just a few, I believe, at the church. They will be having more.
I must say, I stumbled across that in the Hennepin County Government Center, not expecting to see anything there. I just walked by, saw some striking things, walked up close to it, and I was really knocked over by some of the images that were there. They were very
mm-hmm.
strong. So it's even a bigger exhibition over at the Unitarian Society.
Right.
Great. Well, Barb, thanks a lot for being on the show. I'm looking forward to having you back on one way or another to talk about the Minority Ethnic and
Neighborhood
New Presenters program that you work on so hard with the Arts Commission. Thanks a lot for all your hard work.
Thank you.
Thanks, Barb. And we did have that number up earlier for information on the New Presenters program, the Neighborhood Arts program that Barb works on. And if you have questions about anything else we've talked about here on the show, call the City Cable hotline, 673-2234. That's if you have general questions about what we're doing on this show, or if you have suggestions about things you'd like to see on the show. So please stay tuned now for a brief calendar of events about things going on in Minneapolis. And we'll see you again next time. I'm Phill Lindsay.